Bam, Mr. Taru. In this video, we're going to talk about solving quadratic equations, that's equations with a power or degree of 2, by completing the square. Now, when you solve equations, whether they're quadratic or not, linear equations, cubic equations, you can solve them with graphing. We're going to, of course, focus on secondary equations. You can graph them, find out where they cross the x-axis. You can solve them with factoring. You can solve them with completing the square, and you can solve them with at least second-degree equations. You can solve those with the quadratic formula. Great thing about the quadratic formula is it's going to give us a solution to this quadratic equation, regardless of what kind of value it is. It could be a whole number answer, which are usually easy to find with factoring. It could be a rational equation. Again, those are usually solvable by factoring and completing the square. But it also find equations or solutions, that are irrational, like maybe square root of 7. And of course, it'll let us know when there's no solution at all. So why bother with learning how to solve equations with factoring and completing the square? It's because those mathematical techniques are used, you know, in other areas of algebra and just mathematics in general. When you go to learning something called graphing conic sections, your circles, your parabolas, ellipses, and hyperbolas, completing the square is going to be an integral process in those problems. So we have to learn it. And we are going to learn completing the square in this video for just solving equations. We're going to rewrite the equation so that the x terms or whatever variable is in your equation, a's, b's, whatever, but we're going to rewrite the equation so all the terms with the variables in them are going to be on the left-hand side, and the constants, or the constant, take that s out of there, the constant is on the right-hand side. So variables on the left, constant on the right. Now, you cannot complete the square unless the leading coefficient is equal to 1. So we're going to with the leading coefficient equal to 1, we're going to complete the square by adding b divided by 2 squared to both sides of the equation. Now, I teach pre-calculus, and like in this year I've already done videos for and taught, you know, graphing conic sections. So I wrote a note here, but I'm probably going to do my third example. I'm doing 3, by the way, a little bit differently than what I have here in the note. This is more for when you're setting up to graph conic sections. So I'll point this out, but you might want to ignore it. X squared plus bx, and this yellow is us adding the b over 2 squared term to both sides of the equation. Again, the x term's on the left, the constant on the right. We're going to look at that number, that coefficient in front of the x to the first term, the linear term, take that value of b, divide it by 2, square it, and then add it to both sides of the equation. That is going to set up something called a perfect square trinomial. I'm getting ahead of myself here. I've read that written in step 3. And factoring a perfect square trinomial is just sort of a pattern. So I'll get to that in step 3. But this adding b over 2 squared to both sides, that's the completing the square process, and it sets up a perfect square trinomial on the left, which makes the rest of the problem much easier. Now in green over here, I've got this k out front because I have factored out, you know, we need a leading coefficient that's equal to 1 to complete the square. And in pre-calculus, when you're graphing conic sections, your only option is going to be to factor that out of those x terms. Find your value of b, the number in front of the linear term, the x term, divide it by 2, square it, and then add it to both sides. And you won't have the luxury, you'll have to remember what you factored out of those parentheses and apply that multiplication to both sides, because whatever you're going to add inside here is going to be added this number of times. Now, I might show the last example both ways, but if you're just doing algebra 2 and you're just learning how to solve equations, you might be better off just, you know, if there's a 2x squared, just multiply everything in the equation by 2 instead of having it in that factored form. Again, that's more for like pre-calculus or the end of algebra 2 when you're graphing conic sections, that type of notation. Factor the perfect square trinomial on the left, and we're going to do that by square rooting the first and last terms and keeping the middle sign, coming up with your squared binomial. I actually didn't write it. The reason why you can factor the left-hand side through this sort of pattern of just square rooting the first term, square rooting the last term, and keeping the middle sign, and you'll see exactly what I mean by that in the examples here in a second, is because this x squared plus bx plus b over 2 squared, that trinomial on the left-hand side, again, like I just said, is a perfect square trinomial, and thus they factor, you know, just with a pattern. You can actually factor them like you learn how to factor, but this is going to be a little, you know, shortcut or just how the process they all work. And then square root both sides and finish solving for x. So enough of me talking, let's get to some examples. Bye. First example, we have x squared minus 4x plus 12 equals 0. Now, you won't know this in your textbook when you're doing these problems, but this is roughly what the graph looks like, and you'll see that there is no x-intercept. So when we go to try to solve this with completing the square, factoring, quadratic formula, whatever you use, you're not going to get an answer because there is no x-intercept, so thus there's no solution. So with the steps that I just gave you, we're going to isolate the x terms and move the constant to the right. This is a plus 12. Whenever you move across the equal sign, you want to do the opposite math operation to make that happen. So we're going to subtract both sides by 12 and get x squared minus 4x, leave some space for completing the square, and then minus 12. Now that I have my two x terms alone on the left, my leading coefficient is equal to 1, my constant on the right, I'm ready to complete the square. Now to do that, we take half of b, and it's good practice to take the sign along with you, just to, you know, recognize that this is the coefficient of x and it is negative 4, but you're going to square it, and that's going to cancel out the negative anyway. Negative 4 divided by negative 2 is, negative 4 divided by 2 is negative 2 squared, and that is equal to 4. Now, I can do this in my head very quickly, and hopefully you can too, but maybe these numbers are a little bit bigger, or just, I don't know, you're just tapping along the calculator because you're used to using them and you're not really thinking. Let's not forget, if you have a calculator that allows you to see the text as you type it in, your syntax, as it's called, if you were to leave off the parentheses and type negative 2 squared into your calculator, it will give you negative 4 because it's, you know, you're only squaring the negative, the positive 2, and the negative sign is going to float out there and give you an answer of negative 4 or negative whatever it happens to be. So please make sure that you watch those parentheses and use them correctly and get those positive answers that you will be getting that you need from this completing the square process. So negative 2 squared is 4. We're going to add 4 to both sides. Get this out of my way. And this is a perfect square trinomial. Now, I have videos for, you know, going over factoring techniques. So I'm just going to note that completing the square makes a perfect square trinomial and remind you that to factor these perfect square trinomials, you square root the first term, you square root the last term, and you keep the middle sign. So this is going to be square root of x squared is x, so x minus square root of 4 is 2 squared. And if you properly factor this, you would get x minus 2 times x minus 2, which is x minus 2 squared, equals negative 12 plus 4 is negative 8. In the directions I gave you, I said the next step is to, after you finish this factoring process, square root both sides of the equation. Well, when you go to square root both sides of this equation, I'm going to attempt to take the square root of negative 8, and there is no square root of negative 8. There's no number times itself that is going to give you a negative answer. Let's say it was negative 9 temporarily. The square root of negative 9. We might think it's 3, but 3 times 3, a number by itself, multiplied by itself, is going to be positive 9, not negative 9. Oh, well, then it's negative 3. Well, negative 3 times negative 3 is positive 9 again. We cannot square root negative numbers, and we do teach square rooting negative numbers, but the results are what's called imaginary numbers, and we are not dealing with those with these kind of problems. That parabola had no x-intercept, and thus the square rooting process, the completing the square process, will not be able to give us a solution, and indeed no method of solving this quadratic is going to give us a solution because there's no x-intercept. Next example. For our next example, we have solve x squared plus 8x plus 2 equals 10. Now, if I got this set equal to 0, I'm not actually sure if it would factor or not, but again, we're learning the completing the square process, not factoring. So we're going to keep following the steps that I gave you. Get the x terms alone, get the constant on the right, We're going to do that by subtracting by 2. So we have x squared plus 8x equals 8. We're going to remember to leave space to complete the square, which I did not. All right, there we go. And complete the square, that means take half of b, square it, add it to both sides. So half of b, square it. That's going to be 8 divided by 2 is 4. Keep using those parentheses in case you make a sign error if you're just being, well, we don't want to be dependent on the calculator, but a lot of kids use them a lot. Negative, positive 4 squared is 16, so we're going to add that 16 to both sides of the equation. That is going to give us x squared plus 8x plus 16 is equal to 24. This is a perfect square trinomial. I just keep saying that to let you know what it is. You could look that up in your textbook if you would like to read up more on that. But for factoring, because it's a special type of trinomial, square root the first term, square root the last term, and keep that middle sign. So square root of x squared is x. Middle sign is positive. Square root of 16 is 4. And that binomial is, you know, this binomial creating squared. X plus 4 squared is this trinomial again factored. If you don't believe me, write x plus 4 times x plus 4, distribute it together, and you will get that as your answer. Equals 24. We're going to square root both sides to get the power of 2 away from this x plus 4. We don't want to take x plus 4 and FOIL it back out, expand it back out, because we're going to sort of be going in reverse order of how we started this problem, or we're getting back to the beginning. We're going to square root both sides of this equation. The square root and the power of 2, those are inverse functions, so they cancel each other out. When a textbook gives you a square root symbol, the author is expecting for you to only use the positive answer. At least that's the way it is in the textbook that I use. If you introduce your own square root symbol, you do need to account for the fact that there is a positive and negative answer. The square root of 9 is 3 and negative 3, because negative 3 times negative 3 is 9. So anyway, plus or minus the square root of 24. Now, we're not going to be happy with decimals, right? We're not going to be happy with square root symbols that can be reduced. There is a perfect square that's in 24. It's 4 times 6, and 4 is a perfect square. So I'm going to do a little bit of reduction here, a little simplification. X plus 4 is equal to plus or minus the square root of 4 times 6. 4 is a perfect square, so that comes out as 2. We have x plus 4 equals plus or minus 2, square root of 6. Now you can finish solving that for that x. Your teacher might be writing a separate equation, one for the positive answer and one for the negative. I'm just going to keep it as 1. Subtract both sides by 4. Whoops. And get as our final answer, x equals plus or minus 2 square root of 6 minus 4. Now that's great if your book or your teacher or your test asks for a question or your answers in exact form. If I type square root of 6 in my calculator, I get a crazy run-on decimal that never ends and never repeats. It's an irrational number. So any form, any decimal form of this answer, even if you go out 10 decimal places, has been rounded off and not in exact form. However, if I was trying to graph this quadratic, see where that parabola crosses the x-axis, well, it does cross the x-axis here, but if I was trying to graph it, I can't look at this and tell what the decimal versions are. So approximate answers, type this into your calculator, one for the positive, one for the negative. Get those decimal answers. If you're trying to graph this, you want those decimal answers so you know roughly where they go along the x-axis. But this is what your answer looks like in exact form. One more example. Last example. There's that leading coefficient that's not equal to 1. The more I think about this, I'm going to do this example a little bit differently than the notation I used in my notes before as I started this video, because that's, again, that's me just thinking of graphing conic sections, and it's not really the best way to do that notation for solving equations. So x terms alone, constant on the right. We're going to take the 6 and add it over to the right. I need my leading coefficient to be 1. So it's 2. So I'm going to divide everything by 2. Now you might think, oh, well, you know, I kind of set this up nice. All these are even because I knew I was going to divide by 2, but I'm not going to avoid fractions entirely because my b value is equal to 7. And I mean, there's fractions in math, right? So we can't avoid them all the time. And yes, I forgot to leave room for completing the square again. We're going to take half of b, square it, and add it to both sides. So negative 7 divided by 2 squared, that's negative 7 halves. Divided by negative 7 halves, and negative 7 times negative 7 is 49, and of course 2 times 2 is not equal to 2, it's equal to 4. So I'm going to add 49 fourths to both sides of the equation. Okay, so let me take one last step here and get x squared minus 7x plus 49 over 4 equals. Okay, I need a little bit of scratch work, right? Because what's 3 over 1 plus 49 over 4? So we're going to have 3 over 1 plus 49 over 4 doing this little section right here. Of course, you guys know, right? You need a common denominator to add fractions. So that's going to be 12 over 4 plus 49 over 4, and 49 and 10 make 59, and 2 make 61. So we have 12 and 49 is 61 fourths. And just so I'm not making a video with a mistake, let me double check it. Yes, okay. Alrighty, get that erased. Now we're going to factor this perfect square trinomial. Oh, I hate fractions. Okay, deal with it. We're going to square root the first term, keep the middle sign, square root the last term, which is always positive, so I don't really need to keep encompassing that plus sign. When you square root a fraction, just square at the top and square at the bottom separately, like they're two small little questions, and we get square root of x squared is x, keep the middle sign a negative, square root of 49 is 7, square root of 4 is equal to 2. You might notice a pattern. You kind of get those that little bit of scratch work you keep getting as you square root the constant of your perfect square trinomial, and that is a legitimate pattern. It does keep showing up. Oops, what did I forget? I didn't add my... Yes, I did. Scratch that. So 61 over 4. Now, it's what... doing your notes, sometimes you see the notes on the side of your side of my eye here as I'm talking, and I think I see a number that's not really there. Okay, so I've got my binomial squared equal to 61 over 4. I'm going to square root both sides of the equation, not forgetting to include plus or minus because I'm introducing my own square root. And remember, square root of fraction, you can do top and bottom separately, as I've written here. And the square root of 4 is equal to 2. So I'm going to erase that. Square root of 4 is equal to 2. Now, I've already got common denominators on both sides because I'm going to have to, of course, add 7 halves to both sides of the equation to get it away from the x. And our final answer is x equals plus or minus square root of 61 over 2 plus 7 over 2, which can be rewritten as plus or minus square root of 61 plus 7 over 2. Oh, and by the way, the decimal answers to that previous question were 0.9 and negative 8.1. And this is, again, the exact value, the exact form of this answer of where this parabola crosses the x-axis. I'm Mr. Taru. This is completing the square. Bam! Go to your homework.